aplauso, por favor.
I'm actually going to take it for a reason. Hola. Buenas tardes. Guadalajara. All right, that's the extent of my Spanish. So what I was going to actually talk about today, just to give you a sense, I love the city. I was here, last time I was here was 15 years ago, as a student like you guys, traveling through here. And the first thing I did getting out was stop, get my currency exchanged so that I had enough pesos to survive, and then take it all the way for a month, making sure that I had pesos stuffed in all different places in case I got robbed. Today, when I came this time, 15 years later, things were completely different. I started way ahead. I had everything booked ahead of time on Airbnb, hotels.com, whatever you know. And I didn't have to stop for currency exchange. I Ubered, I got there. I don't have any pesos today. Tells you what's going on with money today. We're at a time where change is just, it's exponential. And I think the previous presenter talked about that. Technology is changing so much. Everything is changing around us, how we live, how we buy, how we communicate with each other. And this, I can tell you, is happening so fast in the world of money as well. And while we do have a lot of cryptocurrencies, alternatives to money that are coming up, the adoption of cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin haven't taken off just yet. What is disrupting this industry is mobile. Mobile payments are completely disrupting how we pay, how we look at money, how we send money to each other. We are now becoming more of a less cash society. Not cashless yet, but it's about less cash. We carry less cash with us. And, this is not moving forward. And essentially, with all the change that is going on, we need to prepare for it today. It's no longer okay for us to think about what's going on today and how do I adapt my marketing, my technology, my mindset, my organization to what's going on today. We actually have to plan 5, 15, 20 years ahead to make sure that we are competitive. You're going to change it? Okay. So let me go through here and I'll just change this physically. So one of the things that is driving this change, like I said, is our access to internet. Looking at some of the Latin American statistics, the population with access to internet is growing. In Mexico, almost half of your population has access to internet. And what it is doing is it's presenting a tremendous opportunity for e-commerce. If we look at where we were last year, in Mexico, you had 8 billion transactional volume, and that in 20 years is going to more than double. And if you look at the opportunity, if we look at Latin America, you see that opportunity getting even larger. And then if you think about where the US is, that's 4 times, and that's where we will be catching up. So there is tremendous growth down here in e-commerce, and this is fueled by 80 million new consumers who will start to buy online in the next 5 years. Okay. That's 20% growth. This is 80 new million consumers in Latin America who will start to buy. And you can see the trends for Mexico as well, almost doubling that. Most of this is people buying from on their mobile phones. Actually, you know, if you guys can tell me, how many of you guys have bought something in the last month using your mobile phone? Look at that. It is 30%, mobile commerce accounts for 30% of all Okay, got it. By 2018, this is a global number, nearly half of all e-commerce will come from m-commerce, amounting to $626 billion. And over 1 billion consumers around the globe will make a purchase on their mobile phones in 2018. Okay. Given how important mobile is becoming in our markets, some of the common, today, this is what mobile looks like today. Some of the common mobile payment types and technologies are using everything from using contactless, like near-field communications, and you can see these are the top players in these markets, to location-based beacon technology that will just, if once you walk in, it knows who you are, and it will serve up things to your mobile and allow you to make payments. QR codes, which I know we use a lot over here as well. To point of sale, mobile point of sale. And going over to even how we transfer funds to each other. One of the things, I know in the last presenter actually had talked about the Internet of Things. One of the things that's also really making this mobile industry and more payments industry more exciting is this convergence of mobile with the Internet of Things. So imagine you are here sitting. This is future, and disclaimer, this is not about PayPal technology. This is just what we can envision our technology to be in the next 5-10 years. You walk in to a store. The store automatically knows who you are because of, let's say, a chip, or it has scanned your veins, and it knows who you are, and it serves up personalized information to you on your mobile phone. Because it knows who you are, you've walked in here, and now it tells you, I've got some great discounts, I think you will like this. This is what is happening slowly but surely today. We aren't there with vein scanning, but we are there with mobile beacon, knowing who you are when you walk in and serving up things for you. The convergence of this mobile and Internet of Things is going to also create so much data. Today, there are 5 billion, well, last year, today there are now more than 6 billion connected devices. And what I mean is devices that are connected to the Internet. And when we think about in the next 5 years, this is going to grow to being 25 to 30 billion devices. That growth is what is going to drive this unprecedented data that we are going to get about who is coming, what are they doing, what do they like, where are they going, and how are they connecting on each and every device of theirs. And I want to even get a sense from you guys. How many of you have a mobile phone today? How many of you have a tablet? Computer? Connected TV that streams? Fitbit? No? One. How many of you are in a household where you and your partner or your parent or your whoever you're living with has the same number of devices? Okay, so think about how much data you're actually creating over here and how this data can be monetized. And that is also changing the face of money, because now an advertiser knows what you are searching on your computer, and when you open up your Facebook feed, it sends you that an ad for that, a discount for that, and that's how we are starting to spend today. looking at who is driving, I mean, this is all of us, right? All of you guys. Who is driving this? It's a connected generation. This is a mindset. This is not a group like we have the millennials or the baby boomers, etc. This is the connected generation, people who are using connected devices. They are always on. They are merging. Well, I should say we are always on. We are merging our online and an offline world, and we are changing how we communicate and spend and how we tend to live our lives. The connected generation is, while it is a mindset, 65% of this group was born after 1980. So the millennials make up a huge part of this connected generation. Globally, the millennials are disrupting the way we buy and we pay. 20% of all online shoppers today were born after 1980. 25% are transacting on mobile, and the millennials will spend $200 billion annually, and in their lifetimes, about $10 trillion. Looking at how they are using services, they prefer using new and innovative ways to pay. It's not about your old-fashioned bank. It's not about cash that you're going to give to your friends. The way they are using, they're preferring to use products from innovative companies, not from banks. A third believe that they won't need a bank at all. So imagine a time where it's not, your money is not about a bank. Your money is in your mobile wallet. Most of them, 75%, would be more excited of financial offerings that came from tech startups than from their banks. And I'm not saying banks are bad, but this is just how this population views. One example of how this is happening is Venmo. I know that a lot of these services are not here in Mexico yet, but just to give you a sense of how people are changing the way they're looking at transactions. Venmo is a peer-to-peer service. It's very popular with the millennials. In fact, it's the number one money exchange, a money transfer mechanism amongst this group. Venmo as a product, given the fact that it's a millennial targeted product, it has to be easy. It's easy, it's mobile, and it has social integration. It has a cool factor, and it makes having to pay your friends back fun. Payment volume in Q1 of this year was $3.19 billion. So imagine how much is getting transferred. This is more than a bank is transferring money. A lot of the banks are transferring money. Venmo is overtaking that. And just to do that PayPal pitch, Venmo is part of the PayPal family. This is how easy it is to use. You have a taxi purchase. You have multiple friends who rode with you. You want to split it. You give them a message. You put an emoji. And voila, the request has been sent to them on their phones. And that's it. It's no longer, like I said, it's not shameful to ask your friends to pay you back anymore. And people don't find it offensive to have to pay you back also. The other thing that people are looking at is looking at services and products that are going to help them save time and money. I mean, how many of us need more time in our day? The fact that we are checking everything, we're constantly on. How many of you sleep with your mobile phone, your smartphone right next to you at night? You know who you are, me too. And what do you look at? Do you look at your boyfriend or your girlfriend or your wife or husband? Last thing you look at when you go to sleep, or is it your mobile screen? Come on. You're like, I'm abstaining. And the first thing you look at in the morning, how many of you look at your feed in the morning? Yeah. So we are spending so much of our time on our mobile phones that we actually are looking for more and more services that are going to save us that time and money. 70% of this population believes that within 5 years, paying for things are going to be completely different. And a third feel like credit cards, which is what we use today. And credit card disrupted the cash society, right? But a third of these guys believe that credit cards are the old way of paying. It's not the cool thing, it's not the new thing, it's not a way of saving them time and money. And more than 70% value a simple way, a very seamless, one-click way of purchasing. So just recently, PayPal came up with PayPal One Touch. And this, while it's very simple, and it's very, you know, it's just a simple change in the way you transact online, it's changed completely how conversions are happening online. It's a faster checkout. There is no login, repeat login and password. And it is the best conversion for retailers, according to a ComScore study. It's 87.5% conversion rate, compared to about 46.5% for any other payment method. And to just let you know what that means, out of 100 people who are putting things in their cart on an e-commerce site, 87.5% are actually continuing and making a successful transaction. Whereas if you think about other methods that are not using the One Touch, they are half of them, more than half, are actually dropping off and never completing that transaction. So it's a huge win for even e-commerce sites. I'm sorry, I think the music is not on. You won't be able to hear it, but that's okay. This is how One Touch works, and this has been released in Mexico as well. You put in your email and password once, and you opt into One Touch. You say, I want to do it. And next time you transact, you just check out with PayPal. It doesn't ask you to log in and put in your password again. It takes you straight to the checkout. You can use it at many different merchants. And then you can also, when you think about it, you can use it on your phone. You can connect all your devices to One Touch. You can use it on your phone, on your tablet, and even on your desktop. And just the simple thing of taking away having people re-log in and put in the password each time has just changed the game for merchants in terms of conversion. Looking at also how this population, this connected generation, is transacting, they are merging social. How many of you, before you make a transaction, how many of you read reviews online? Yeah. How many of you decide that it's better to look at the reviews than it is to look at the ads or the company's information? Yeah, so there we go. 45% more likely to trust experts than ads, and 2.5 times more likely to be influenced by blogs and social media. That's how we are transacting today. We are asking each other. We are generating content that talks about a brand rather than going to that brand and understanding what it is all about. 30% of all social network users have bought an item directly from the social media platform in the last month. This is more of a US stat, but this is something that is going to come to all parts of the world quite fast, given that how technology is moving today. Looking at one example, Pinterest. Pinterest came out with a buy button last year. How many of you have looked at stuff on Pinterest? Yeah, and how many of you have been irritated that when you like something on Pinterest and then you wanted to buy it, it took you all the way to different sites, some other e-commerce merchant, and then you had to figure out, and you had to add in all your information, and then check out. And how many of you dropped off? Okay. What Pinterest did, which was quite awesome, was last year they came up with a buy button. And they put that right next to the pin it button. And today, if I am searching for something, like my stool, or a blanket, or a tent, I can buy it right away. This makes things simple. It reduces, again, that aspect of dropping off. It keeps you on that platform doing more. All right, okay. Looking at, you know, looking at again this group, we are always on. We are uniting the online and offline world, and more than 70% value smart and personalized self-service tools. You don't want to be on a call with people asking them how to use the product or having to do some things and then call in to make that order. We all want self-service tools so that we can operate whenever we want. If it's in the middle of the night, it is early part of the day, or if it's during our work time, lunch hour. We want the tools at our fingertips and allowing us to make those transactions. We are yearning for those seamless experiences. And one of the things that Facebook did, Facebook Messenger partnered up with Uber, and they made basically your hailing for a cab, they changed that completely. Now, if you look at how you want to get a ride, you're having a conversation in your Messenger, you have an address in there, you just tap on it, you request a ride, Uber pops up. You can see where you're going also, so you can say, okay, where do I need to go? And how much is it going to cost me? And boom, everything is done. There's no fear factor of you guys are going to end up in different places because both of you are using the same address and calling right from that app. This is something that Messenger just launched, and plugging in PayPal again, PayPal is actually processing these payments. You know, it is more than PayPal, right? It is about selling the experience. For us, today, we expect that we will be experiencing things. And for companies, it's not about having a social platform that's talking about something and then moving them to an e-commerce platform that allows them to buy and then payments platform is somewhere else. No, it's all about bringing it all together and having an experience. And so we as merchants, as e-commerce developers, as also consumers of this, we are looking for designing meaningful experiences that are magical and frictionless. It is magical. It is about, we expect it actually today, that it should be frictionless and magical. And because of that, we as merchants, as companies, we need to know each customer across every touch point. And as you know, with all the connected devices you guys have, we all have, that touch point is no longer one touch point. That touch point is multiple touch points. And we need to be able to track that customer across that journey from device to device to touch point to touch point. And we need to connect with them. We need to use mobile to connect and guide optimized digital experiences. Because if you don't guide these consumers, they will come up with their own ideas of your brand. Think about it, they are talking about your brand. They are creating lots of content. They are reviewing your content. They are reviewing your products. And if you are not in the mix having that conversation with them, they are going to define your brand for you, and you don't want that to happen. So use this technology to guide them to have the experience that you want them to have. Personalize the engagements based on context and content. They are creating content. Be part of that connection with them and co-create content with them. Don't just let them create it. And again, loyalty is important for these users. It's not, you know, a lot of times people say, oh, because there are so many devices and people are going mobile, people are not loyal. No, actually, loyalty is very important to this customer. And you want to use techniques like gamification and rewards, but they have to be personalized. They have to be personalized incentives that help trigger buys and shares. One company that is doing this well is Starbucks. Starbucks is selling the experience. I mean, if you think about it, you're paying, I'm not sure how much you're paying in Mexico. Can someone shout out? What do you pay for like a Frappuccino or your coffee in a Starbucks here? $4? Okay, más o menos. So $4, that's something like $4, and in the US we are paying about $5 at times. Something that you're paying $4 to $5 for coffee that you can walk down the street and get it for a dollar or make it at home for, I don't know, for pennies. You are willing to pay that for Starbucks. That is amazing. And Starbucks didn't always have it. It did come up, it created this experience, but you know, there was a time that we all kind of caught on and their in-store transactions were dwindling. They were just going down and they had to think about what do you do, what do we do now? And Starbucks in 2009 came up with an app. They said, let's have an app so that a user knows where the next Starbucks is. So they started out with letting users be able to map where the next Starbucks is. And very quickly, Starbucks realized that they needed to do more. They came up with their mobile wallet that allowed users to put in the money in the wallet and use it. Today, the new mobile wallet offering is leading the way in mobile payments. It was essentially the first wallet that was adopted across many people. The adoption today is more than 17 million mobile app users globally, and it accounts for 21% of in-store transactions. 21% from where they had dwindling in-store transactions to now people using their mobile wallet, the Starbucks wallet. They are also constantly changing what they are giving with their mobile wallet. Today, they've had offerings, they have partnerships with Lyft, and Spotify, and New York Times. So imagine the data that they are collecting. They know where, when you want to come. They know when you're going to arrive in the shop, where you're going after. They know what type of music you like, what you tend to stream. They know what you like to read. And they can actually now even tailor the experience and tie in what you're drinking to how what your personality preferences are. And they have their automatic loyalty rewards. You know, in a time where people said loyalty is dead because the millennial generation doesn't care, it's not loyal because they're gonna hop onto different experiences, this Starbucks experience actually proved them wrong. Automatic loyalty reward programs in Starbucks keeps the customer coming back for more. So for example, for me, I need my coffee. I don't know about you guys, but I need my coffee first thing in the morning. If not, I'm not a happy person. So I don't want, I know, and everyone is in the same boat, and there's a huge line at Starbucks. I use my mobile wallet, my Starbucks app, to essentially order my drink ahead of time, and when I get there, I don't have to stand in line behind 50, you know, 20, 25 people. I go walk up straight to the counter. I've already paid for it. They have a cup waiting for me with my name. I can take it and off I go, and I'm done. That is what is keeping Starbucks a personalization, as a personalization genius, that's what's keeping Starbucks more and more important and enriching their company offerings. They also, in addition to the pay ahead and order ahead and pay, they also allow you to earn and redeem points. So depending on how many drinks you've had, every 10th drink is free on the house. They know what your favorite drink is, they can give it to you. They know when your birthday is, so they give you a nice little birthday treat on your birthday. And what they've realized is it's not only about delighting the customer, it's actually also financially giving back to Starbucks much more. Loyalty members are spending 3 times more than non-members. They're going to the same Starbucks store, but they are spending 3 times more. So, in the words of Elon Musk, tell me, how many of you know Elon Musk? All right. Elon Musk was a co-founder of PayPal, but today he's known for Tesla and SpaceX. He's the founder of those two companies, and he is known as a genius. When you think about what he's saying, he said that it was never about money, but about solving problems for the future of humanity. And that is what, when we think about money, when I think about how PayPal thinks about money, it's not about monetizing, it's not about how people are using money, but it's about solving a problem, a need that they have when it comes to their money. Looking at, you know, how PayPal looks at this, can you guys see it? Yeah. PayPal is looking at democratizing money. It's about giving people their, helping them manage, giving them control over their financial health. And so as you have funds coming in, PayPal's view is, hey, people have different ways of accessing money. And it can be through cash. We are still not a cash-free society, and maybe we will never be cash-free. We are a less cash society, so we need to find different ways for letting people bring in their monies the way they want to. It's about having your bank account. So even though more and more people are moving away from bank, banks are still around, and they still have a lot of your money. It's about using credit and debit. Along with cash also comes cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin. That is also a currency that some people are using. Loans and how we transfer funds to each other. It's taking all of these in and helping with tools that will help people manage these, budget, and be able to use their monies in the way they want. If they want it online, in store, using mobile, or using desktop. If they want to remove this money through ATM. If they want to actually send a remittance, you want to send a remittance to your cousin in El Salvador, it is allowing you to be able to do that without incurring a lot of costs or standing in a long line at Western Union, or having to pay your bills, your regular bills. And it is looking at, okay, and it's looking at, in a sense, PayPal is looking at being that end-to-end platform, which is agnostic, which comes in with Zoom that we just acquired, doing this community empowerment, letting you transfer your funds, send money as remittances to other countries, or doing social commerce, where asking and splitting your rent, splitting your dinner bill, splitting your cab fare is fun, and you can ask your friends to do it. Or the next generation commerce, like the One Touch, like letting you as a merchant process Bitcoin as a currency. It is how do we enable merchants to be able to process all different kinds of currencies or payment methods to Paydiant, which is allowing that merchant to build their own app and process loyalties and payments within their own branded app rather than moving to a PayPal branded app. To let you go with, this is the inspiration of what PayPal sees the future of money to be, future of payments to be. Am I in the way? I've done that a lot of times. Okay, how many of you are inspired? Come on, at least for me. You know, I mean, there were some key takeaways that we talked, that I discussed during this 1 hour, but I'm going to leave that. Why, do you guys have any questions? I know we are out of time, but any questions or anything that you would like to, yes.
Well, I'm like just afraid when I have my mobile with me. I'm just thinking about this, all the apps that let you pay with PayPal or other ways of pay. But I'm like, okay, if in the future you will pay all in your cell phone, what happen if by any chance your cell
security.
Phone...
Security.
What?
Yeah, security. Security.
Yes, just the security. It's like, okay, all is getting simple, it's just one click, and it's less security because you need to save time. But what will happen with your money if the phone is not with you or your computer?
So security is one of the pieces that as we move more and more to mobile, it is becoming the hot topic. And today, companies are using things. Apple Pay, for example, uses tokenization to make sure that you have security. People are using SSL encryption, obviously. And then Venmo, for example, moved to multi-factor security as well. So it's also, if it doesn't recognize you, then it's making sure that you have other security terms or a number that you're putting in. Obviously, more than just about security of payments, it's also about securing your mobile identity, right? So when you think about how we are securing our mobile identity today, a lot of us are using fingerprinting as a biometric security measure. More and more people are thinking that the next steps in this is going to go down the route of biometrics, where there might be, given that we have a camera on our phone, we might be scanning our iris, we might be taking a selfie, and that's going to actually make sure that it's you, or it might be, like I said, vein scanning, so scanning your hand to make sure that it's you. These are all some security measures that people are working on. They are not out yet. Right now, the main one is the biometric and obviously our old password way. But it is something that is coming up more and more as we're using our mobiles for everything, obviously.
What's your take on, not long ago, I read an article about Swedish banks that were like...
The RFID wristbands?
Uh-huh. They launched an app called, I have actually the article here, it's called Swish, and they started like to integrate a lot of, like, their take is to like literally eliminate all the use of cash,
right,
and only use the app. And like, what's your take on that in the sense of banks joining forces and even I think the government has a strong involvement?
I think as much as we are becoming a less cash society, I don't think we're ever going to be at a point where we are completely cash free. We are moving towards that, but cash for small transactions, cash is always king. If you're going to the supermarket and you're buying a banana off, you know, or you're buying a fruit cocktail off the street vendor, chances are you're not going to be using your credit card over there. Chances are you might be using cash. But I think there are more. I mean, I would say like Venmo, people are tending to use more and more their different apps rather than cash. And that is going to continue. It will continue down that stream. It may never just go away.
Hi. I have a question in regards to traditional banks. I believe that most of us feel like upset or set of traditional ways of banks. For example, we have a good example here, Banamex. They're on every hallway trying to sell credit cards. And they use your information. They call you every time they can to sell you their services. So I dream of a society in which we can release from banks. And that's pretty much what is driving fintech. What efforts is PayPal doing in regards to, for example, collecting payments from companies? For example, I get paid. I don't want to get paid through a bank. I want to get paid directly to PayPal and then manage my money there and do all my payments through PayPal. Is that something that could be possible in regards to customer engagement?
I think that is a long-term vision for PayPal. But if you also think about your traditional banks, they are changing. They have realized that they are losing you as a customer. And you're finding other ways. And fintech is coming in, and new startups are coming in and taking over. And those traditional banks are also now transforming. There, if you look, there are lots of partnerships that they're having with digital companies, or they are building out their own digital fintech arm within the bank so that they can continue to service you in the way you need to be serviced, that you want to be serviced rather than how they want to service you. Make sense? Are we out of time or? Oh, okay.
How do you think that the companies who... How do you think that the companies who are heading this less money revolution will take over countries like Mexico, which have this like so split economy with their population, countries that have a lot of extremely poor people?
Got it, the haves and the have-nots. So the thing that actually excites me about PayPal's vision, and I feel very proud to be part of it, that's why I'm speaking this way. But the thing that excites me is that they are looking, our CEO does look at that. He is thinking about this digital divide when it comes to money, and how do we, you know, like it said, how do we democratize money, democratize finance, and this aspect of making transfer of money to be easier, to not be as costly. He talked about looking at how remittances were done and how people have to stand in long lines just to send money across the border so that their mother has money to pay for her food. Literally, it's about not money being sent so that I can spend money and buy, you know, what are cool things I want. It's about life and death, right? But you have to spend so much time standing in line with lots of fees on it. And the point is that with fintech, that shouldn't happen. With digital, the way we are today, that should not happen. And so PayPal's view is that we have to start thinking about how to make access to money and transfer of money easier for everyone, not just, and that's why it says, you know, money is not for the few, the elite few, it is actually for everyone. It's a vision. We'll get there, but it's a vision.
Hi. There are some industries that are so traditional that maybe the type of paying or buying via PayPal is not that easily as
it's not.
Other. Is there any form or a kind of help that PayPal helps so those industries to involve to this? I don't know. Maybe if I'm an agency and I want to pay or I want to charge all my service to an industry, is there any way that PayPal helps me to talk to this industry or my client in the fact that we can make that operation, this transaction?
So I think it'll be good for, I will actually refer, I know we are running out of time, I will refer you to the PayPal booth, because there are some things that are more low tech, like invoicing that is available. But in terms of, you know, making overall industry changes and moving traditional cash-based industries to go more digital, PayPal is working on things. So when you think about charitable industry, which was always more of checks, PayPal is working to make donations much simpler. We just announced that we are going to be launching in our PayPal app where you can send and receive money. We are going to receive payments in Mexico. We're going to add a donate button. So now you don't have to go to a donation site and then donate to that charity on their website. You can actually go within your app and donate. So that's one place where it is making that change, making it simpler. But you know, the view is, the vision is that we will be a platform that people can use. It's not about proprietary industries. It's about creating this ecosystem. Okay?
Hi. Well, we have talked about the security within the phones for us to be able to use the app and the purchasing. But when you get to a country when it's not that trustworthy to do online shopping or possibly just use any type of payment, including, well, PayPal. I actually grew up in the US, so for me it was easy for me to use PayPal here in Mexico. But I have known a lot of people from my generation, millennials or the Generation Z, where they actually not trust that much online shopping or PayPal or any type of transaction.
Right, and the thing is that it's gonna be a trend that people are going to get onto the train, right? Because as right now, people who are wary, and the security concerns are there, and that is one of the things in Latin America where the adoption of e-commerce has been later than adoption of e-commerce in Europe. Essentially, what is happening with changing some of those attitudes and looking at security, a lot of it is that it's an attitude. It's not trusting that this can actually be safe, right? And there are lots of reasons of all the financial crises that happened and the banks' financial crises that happened in Latin America, for example. So those attitudes are changing, though. As you are finding that it is more convenient for you to shop online, and the retail stores are now coming up with online shops as well, it is becoming more and more acceptable for people to go and do that online shopping. And the fact that they are not using something like PayPal, where they're not giving their credit card information to a merchant on the other side of the world. A lot of them are using services like PayPal or other wallet services because they know that the merchant is actually not going to get that. Okay. I know that we are over, so I'm going to... Two more questions? Okay. All right. Thank you so much, guys.